very handsome gentlemen there. Norm, would you introduce us to these gentlemen, please?
Okay. Before I had a camera like I do now, I always packed a rifle and I basically trophy hunted. And this is my son on to one side, and this is one of his rams. And this is in the Northern Rockies. And just beyond Abe's knee there is about a 2,000 foot drop off. And so as I've got older, I got a camera and I started to take pictures. And my son thinks I've lost my marbles because I put the rifle away, but it's harder to take a good picture even than to do something like this, I think.
Yeah, yeah. How much of the animal are we not seeing there?
Well, the body is behind the head and horns. It's laying kind of like straight towards us.
Yeah. And your hunting turned into photography. So the word shooting evolved from one particular activity to another. And you have achieved notoriety, a considerable notoriety. You are probably the best known member of our club nationally, and maybe even to some extent internationally. So while the club has many times, at least three times that I can find in the records, celebrated your accomplishments, were you taking pictures all your life, or when would you have first picked up the camera with serious intention?
When I was a boy, I had an uncle that he was a birder, basically, and he introduced me to kind of birding. And at that time, it used to be egg collecting, which is no longer legal. And I used to go around every spring and I looked for birds' nests and found them. And every now and then I found something that I'd have to help get my uncle to help me identify. And he was interested in photography at that time. And he gave me a super Graflex that he was no longer using because he'd bought a Hasselblad. Uh-huh. And it was a big thing. And I packed it around. I took 2¼ slides. And then I kind of got away from that. Actually, when I was in Kimberley, there was a camera club there. And I joined, and at that time I bought my first 35 millimeter film camera. And then I kind of got away from that, and I had a little just printed pictures became popular. I had a little pocket camera that was built in Germany, and I might take a picture like this. Or maybe a sunset off a mountaintop or something, because that's where we're sleeping the night. And when I came home and retired and I bought my first digital camera, it was actually a Nikon. And it was kind of what they call a prosumer. And then I upgraded to a 20D Canon. And at that time, Canon had image stabilized lenses and were much ahead of Nikon. So that made that decision pretty easy. And then I started trying to take birds and stuff. And I first bought a 1-400 lens. And then I realized that wasn't long enough. And then I bought a 500. And then I bought a 600. And probably the next slide tells the best next part of the story.
Well, the good news is I've inserted some slides. So the next slide is a little more recent.
Oh, okay. Well, this is a little different.
What is the secret to your success? Why have people responded so positively, both within the club, within Kappa, in your friendship circles, and in other photographic circles? I mean, simple question, complicated answer. What's your secret?
Probably outhouse luck. I don't know. I'm maybe I'm a little nerdy. I try to get as detailed as I can, and I certainly try to capture a moment. When I got into the club, I didn't know how to run my camera really. I got signed up by Donna Nesjan at that time, and I remember seeing a couple of her bluebird pictures, and I wished I could take a picture as good as that.
Yeah.
And then it's just gone on from there. And of course, if you're entering in CAPA contests and you're like an individual member, you have to enter four pictures. And that's difficult to have four. The judges usually don't like one of them as much as you think they should. And how to judge the judges is, that's where the outhouse luck, I think, comes in.
I think it's fair to say you pay attention to detail. You've mastered your craft and your equipment. And we're going to talk updated gear later on. But anyway, you set the stage. And my question to everyone, and don't hold your comments for now, is what makes Norm's work so appealing? Second question, what is Carrie's role in all this? Carrie is very shy. Pardon me for suggesting this, Carrie. We don't see a lot, or I haven't seen a lot of her work, but how does Carrie fit into all this? Because you two are a team. What's Carrie's contribution to all this?
Well, in my words or her words?
Well, that's a very good question. Let's start with her. Carrie, are you near a microphone, and can you jump in here? And you may be muted. You'll need to unmute yourself.
Well, the thing about taking photos is going out in the country, and I really love the backwoods and not too many people. Like, we go where there's not any crowds or anything, and that's what I enjoy most about it. And also, I'm able to critique his photos, and that seems to work out okay too, you know, or give him suggestions. Hey, you should take a shot of this kind of thing, you know. But yeah. Anyhow, I really enjoy being out. And besides that, sometimes I take photos, and other times I have a great book that I can read while he's doing that.
Yeah. Very, you know, I heard a story that at one time he said the reason he married you is you could carry a pack. Is that true?
That could be true, but it was for going out in the bush and camping out. It wasn't
Yeah. You see, I've got some inside information from various places. One place is that Valerie Rampone wrote a fine article on Norm, I think in 2017, or maybe it was even earlier. And I've quoted her a little bit on this. If you'd been on Vancouver Island about 60 years ago, it could be 70 now, in the Duncan Shaunigan Lake area. Shaunigan Lake is about 45 minutes north of Vancouver on the Malahat. Oh, and by the way, they just declared the Malahat structurally unsafe today. And there's only one lane traffic for essential travel only. They are going to have to rebuild the Malahat Highway. Isn't that incredible? Anyway. You might have seen a couple of guys and a kid heading out fishing. The guys took the kid along because the kid had an innate sense of where the fish were. Norm talked about that just a minute ago. The kid was Norm Dougan, and he always found the fish for his family friends. That intuitive sense of where to find wildlife is still serving Norm well these days, as he treks into an Alaskan glacier, backpacks in the Rockies, or dons hip waders for a sortie into the wetlands of Texas with his camera gear. His forte is in capturing the image. I mean, so much of photography is showing up at the right place in the right time, and in Norm's case, wearing the right clothing. Now, there's another connection I have with Norm, and it comes through my wife. My wife, Kathy, grew up in Shaunigan Lake. Her father was Les Batchelor, who died about 4 or 5 years ago. Les apprenticed under Norm's father, Ray Dougan. that was a fascinating training because they did heavy duty. They did small cars, middle-sized cars. They did logging equipment. They collected the mail. They did all sorts of things in the Shawnigan Lake of those days. It was a fabulous place to grow up. Norm's dad, Ray, wanted my father-in-law, Les, to actually take over the shop, but Les moved in other directions and eventually came to Kamloops to be one of the founding faculty in heavy-duty mechanics of what was then called Caribou College. But the environment in which Kathy grew up is very similar to the environment Norm grew up in. Now, when my wife gets a little bit sleepy driving the car, I distract her with questions. So I say to her, what was it like to grow up in Shawnigan? So Norm, what was it like to grow up in Shawnigan?
Well, I guess it's how you look at that. Certainly I was the oldest of six children, and my dad had this thought that an idle mind was a devil's playground. And he tried to take care of that as much as he could. And so from the time I was a young boy, I had chores around the house, big garden, lawns, and there was this garage. And there was always cleanup and parts to be cleaned and gas to be served and everything like that. And the one thing was, it was Sunday morning, and he would say, if I was home, what are you doing today? And if I said, I don't know, he would have a job for me. So I kind of learned at that time, if I got up at 5 a.m. and went up to the Coaxsala River on my bike or down to the creek where I could walk to on Shawnigan Creek or to go fishing, or I had a fellow that owned the store next door, Archie Aiken, and he always had a boat, and he painted that and resurfaced that boat every year, and he says, that's your boat to fish in. And I'd go out fishing on Shawnigan Lake. And the first part, though, Dad and Mom said, well, you got to be able to swim 200 yards before you can go out by yourself. And so that was a real trial, and once I made the 200 yards, I wondered what all these other dumb people were doing going swimming and stuff when they could be fishing. And I learned how to fish. I had Archie as a mentor, and then I had a fellow called Felix Lukovich, and he taught me both to fish and hunt what he knew. And of course, then Felix couldn't always go or whatever. And there was other people that wanted to get some fish. And I knew how to fish, and I knew how to bait the hook, and I knew how to get the right roll in the herring. And we could always go out and catch more than most other people in the bay. And so that was kind of a little bit about growing up. And what I really got involved in the outdoors, because that idle mind was a devil's playground. And if I stayed home, I had a job. And if I got up early on Sundays only, mind you, I could have the day to myself. So I'd have a lunch, I'd go out, and I'd go at 5, and Dad wasn't up yet. And I wouldn't get home till after dark. And that was how I grew up.
The way we grew up does not ultimately determine the person we become, but it sure has an influence. Now, one interesting story that you had told me about and I had heard from my father-in-law was Ripple Rock. Can you tell us about Ripple Rock? And then we'll get to your images, I promise.
Well, when they were going to blast Ripple Rock out of...
You better tell people where it is or was.
In Seymour Narrows, it's just north of Campbell River. And it was kind of a graveyard of ships over the years, because there's a very high tidal flow through there. The tide runs about 16, 17 knots on a big flood or a big ebb. And of course, this rock was right, there was a twin rock, and it was right in the middle of the channel in the narrowest spot. And so that, because of the tides and the motion of the water, it could take you right into the rock. And of course, if you hit the rock, the boat seemed to sink after that. And many lives were lost there. So the government decided they were going to blast Ripple Rock out. And they went out on Quadra Island and they sunk a shaft down and they tunneled underneath the rock and they filled the whole two rocks in with dynamite. And it was that time, it was the biggest explosion that, this is before atomic explosions, that had, other than atomic explosions, had ever been exploded. And my dad had a Super 8, couple Super 8 movie cameras at the time, and he was kind of into taking movies. So he said, we should go up and see that. And so my uncle, he had a Hasselblad still camera, and dad had a big camera, and I had this older movie camera, and we went up and the day before, and we drove up a road, up a stream that comes in, and we drove way back in there because we understood that the Mounties were closing the road at 4 o'clock that afternoon. So we drove up this old skid road, and it was actually an old railroad grade that they used for old logging railroads. And we got the Volkswagen van in under the trees, and then I cut alder trees and limbs to put over it because we thought they were going to have an air search because there was supposed to be 125 policemen guarding the area. And anyway, we stuck down that night down the creek and we kind of looked at where do we go in the morning. And I wanted to go onto one of the points right adjacent to the rock, but my father and my uncle kind of picked this other rock bluff right behind the main bunkers where the dignitaries were going to sit. And we had to go about 2.5 miles or maybe a little further through the forest from where we were to find that rock in the morning, that rock bluff. And so I was the guy that knew how to run a compass, knew how to read a map, and kind of did the navigating. And ended up, we got up on top of this rock bluff and we're going to where we're going to set up our cameras. And my uncle gives me a little elbow and he points and here's a bum sticking up behind a log. In other words, we weren't quite alone up there. And actually my dad had a radio so that we knew when the block was going to blow. And they had a countdown going 25, 24, 23. And meanwhile, you're all lined up on the rock with your cameras. And as it got closer, there was a few seconds and it kept getting darker and darker. The weather was getting ready for a heavy rain. And after about 2 seconds when it went zero, all of a sudden the whole ocean came up. And of course I'm on full telephoto on the movie camera. And the first thing you do is you go back to wide angle on a zoom lens. But what I really saw at that time, I thought we would be enveloped in the explosion. Of course, once it goes up high enough, then it falls away. And where I'd wanted to go and I'd been outvoted, there was huge boulders went in there that were like 25 or 30 feet diameter. So really, I guess experience is something to be listened to. Anyway, we were, anyway, when we were coming out after the blast, it was almost like it triggered the rain, and it was almost the rain as heavy as what we've seen the last few days.
Yeah.
And we were coming out.
And even then, you worked very hard to get the shot, to get yourself in position, and you were patient, which I gather you're not always, and sometimes we listen to advice and sometimes we don't. We're glad you did listen to it then. We got some flower shots. Can you set these up a bit for us?
Yeah, this is down on Hurricane Ridge in Washington State, and around here, if you go out in the Skonlith, you have the glacier lily, the yellow ones. And in this particular area, they're the white lily and they're called an avalanche lily. And so what I was trying to do was use my wide angle lens, lay down and take a picture right into the sun and not get too much sun flare in it, because it was just a beautiful alpine meadow. This is a photo stack of a little sparrowhead orchid. Now, Terry Conroy had gone and he'd found these different orchids over north of Donald, I think from Flora, BC. And so we decided to make a trip over there to try and photograph them. He'd done a recce there and he'd taken some pictures. And so we went, I think, on two different years, and we camped there during their bloom period. And this is a focus stack. It was, I think, about 20 images. And the secret of that, of course, is you got zero wind. And I'm wide open on the lens, and my macros are 3.5. But if you set it at 3.5, the green shrubbery in the background goes into a beautiful blur bouquet. And then I put the different images together in Photoshop. And this is called a sparrow egg orchid.
How do you know how many photos you're going to have to stack? Because you can't really see them in the field, can you?
Well, what I did, I got a slide rail that's about 3 inches long. And I decided from that back petal to the front of the leaf is about 3 inches. And I think I was moving at the distance I was, because if you're closer, it's less. And if you're further back, it's more. But I was moving about 3 millimeters for each photo.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. By the way, I should say
2.5 inches.
Yeah. I should say that some of the images I've cropped because, and I hope it's okay, because I've set this up in PowerPoint and I've used some of their suggestions for page layout, but in some cases they might not be the same proportions as the original.
Yeah, this is the yellow lady slipper. And this is where two are kind of just growing in together. And again, it's a focus stack, a little dew on the lady slippers. And again, a stunning flower. The actual slipper itself is about 2.25 inches long or so. And they're just a stunner, and they only grow in certain places, kind of generally quite boggy ground. Now, this is not with a macro lens. I was photographing Lewis woodpeckers down by Savannah, and I looked around, and here this milkweed was in the ditch, and it had a yellow sandbank behind it, and I turned around with my 600 lens that I'd been using to try and photograph the Lewis woodpeckers, and I kind of got parallel to the buds and the flowers. And I took a number of shots at different f-stops because I wanted enough depth of field to get through the flower. And actually, it worked exceedingly well.
And what would the original have looked like? Like, this is fairly high key, nice bokeh. I mean, what would we have seen if we'd seen you shooting the original? You said it was in a ditch, so very dark?
Well, yeah, but there was a yellow sandbank directly behind it.
Yeah.
And that's where the yellow comes in.
Yeah.
And the sandbank was far enough back that with the 600 lens, which has a very shallow depth of field, it just puts it into a beautiful bokeh of yellow.
Yeah.
And it just actually worked. I think the colors kind of coordinated with each other. You know, if I had to pick that background, I might have picked something different, but that was what was there. And every now and then you find that what's there works better than what you might have thought it would.
Yeah, it's just beautifully subtle. Yeah.
Now, I had a friend that actually, it's a guy I met at Lac Lejeune originally. He was up photographing loons, and Andy Rogers, and he was great at booking stuff. And he wanted to go in and photograph the wave in northern Arizona. And so we hiked in, it's about 5 or 6 miles, and you had to book it through the BLM. And we got that booking, and then we got a lady to take us in her 4x4, and we were lucky going in. It had been, the road had been real muddy and it had been impassable for about a week, but it froze up that morning and we made it in there. And there was supposed to be, I think, a dozen other people in there that day, but none of them showed up. So we had the whole place to ourselves. It was basically because of the road condition. And here we had this second wave and we were kind of photographing the sandstone. And Andy said, well, I think we got the shot, let's go. And I said, well, I think we better wait till sunset. He said, then we'll have to walk out in the dark. And I said, we got headlights, that's all right. And anyway, this is the sunset shot of the second wave.
We're only on slide 14 of 98. So I'll just move through the next few,
fairly fast. This is Toro Weep on the Grand Canyon. It's 3,500 feet straight down. And this is sunrise one morning.
And we're talking how early? 6 a.m., 5 a.m.?
I don't know. Whenever sunrise was, it's kind of winter time, so it might not be that early. It's just that it's cold and you got to get up. And the wind's blowing about 35, which you don't really appreciate in this picture.
Yeah.
But when you're hanging over the side, your tripod is like an extra leg and support so that you don't get blown off. This is in Alaska here. It's the Worthington Glacier. And it was just a stunning place where the fireweed was growing along this little stream that had come out of the glacier, and a little white paintbrush there. And this is just as the sun's starting to hit the high peaks. This is sort of, I think, Klaus and Cindy were up here this year. This is on the Dempster Highway. Heading up to Inuvik, and I don't know, I found it really hard to take a compulsive picture there because it's beautiful, but the mountains are just miles and miles away. But here's a nice morning on a little small lake. And I
is that a panorama or is it just a crop?
No, that's a panorama.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now here's the Alpenglow on Mount Rainier down in Washington State. Few lupins in the foreground, fog in the valley. And I tried that shot about, I think this was the fourth day. And the first three were, I was in the clouds. And the fourth day I had this beautiful Alpenglow on Mount Rainier. This is, if ever, any of you ever want to go to the most beautiful place in the Rockies, it's Lake O'Hara. And one of the best times to go, of course, is when the larches turn. It's about the 23rd of September, plus or minus a little bit. And this is a little tarn in the Opavin Basin. There's a little campsite in there that you can book. It's one of those tricks from heaven if you get are able to book it. And Andy, this friend of mine, this Andy Rogers, he was a genius at booking it. So we booked the campground for about 3 different years. But this was one of the best years we had for color and weather.
You often come back to sites over and over again?
If I think it's something I really am enamored with, yeah.
I often think that's the difference between the amateur and the professional. The amateur sort of says, well, that's the best I can do. The professional comes back tomorrow or next month or next year until they get what they're looking for. Yeah.
Now this one is, I was hiking up to photograph the bighorn sheep in Wilcox Pass. That's looking at the Athabasca Glacier, and that's the moon. And as you can see the little trail down below me, that's what I was hiking up on with my headlight. And I left about 2 hours before daylight so I could be up on top for first light to try and get some bighorn ram pictures. But probably this was the best picture I got that day.
Norm takes phenomenal nature shots, Val says, from the tiniest of birds to the largest of elk, grizzlies and magnificent landscapes. His carefully crafted images routinely take top marks in KPAC, Kamloops Photo Arts Club competition selections. He is, however, a relatively newcomer to the art of photography, discounting a few 35 millimeter shots taken to document mine sites in such places as Indonesia and Iran, where his mining engineer career took him and his wife, Carrie.
Okay, well, we've just left the mine. This is the glacier mine, this one out. And this is Takaka Falls in Yoho Park. And you got a beautiful rainbow there. The only thing I'd say, if you go to photograph this, in the summer, and when the glacier's melting, you get the biggest fall. And if you get too close to it, you'll have so many droplets on your lens, you'll discard the shots.
Yeah.
I had a whole bunch after this that I thought might be better, and I'd clean the lens, pull it out, but you're too late. You know, you got to be behind the spray. This was just a spring loco, as is out on the Long Lake Road, and there's an old barn there. It's from Peter Phillip family, from his father and that, and grandparents. And this is a logging truck coming in the early morning, and I was setting up here to do a sunrise, and I heard the logging truck coming, so I upped my ISO and managed to essentially freeze the truck. This is out on Kamloops Lake, where the Tronkiel River comes in, and I think it's one of the nicer landscapes for sunsets in the Kamloops area. It's just because you got the river coming in, and you got a leading line coming in, and then you got a nice sunset sometimes. Now, if you go out there five times, well, I'm not very good at predicting sunsets. I might get one out of five. This is Kamloops, the meeting of the waters. And this is, you hike up from in behind, I guess it's where the old bunkers used to be, and looking down, but it does make a nice panorama. Now, of course, that other picture where I showed you the moon and hiking up to the Rams, this is why it's worthwhile going up early. You got to find them. You got to get them lined up. They got to get comfortable with you. And then you're able to get some wonderful photographs. Now, I was kind of lucky this day. There was three Ram bands, and they all came together for a little meeting. And then they all dispersed. Three Ram bands scattered all over again. Now, this is one of the bands after they had dispersed. And this is looking down Wilcox Pass to the north. And if you dropped over that thing on the end, that's the roads down there that comes up to the ice fields. Like the ice fields goes behind that mountain. The ice field highway goes beyond that mountain on the left. But it makes a better landscape when you can throw these guys in the foreground. This is one of the nicer ramps that I ever saw in there. And he was up on a little knob, and I kind of hiked up. And all of a sudden, he decided he was coming down, and he walked by with me about 15 feet away. And this is the shot of him. But a beautiful, beautiful ram. Not broken or anything, just a marvelous specimen.
Those horns are a work of art. Oh, my gosh. Yeah.
And this is one of the bigger rams that I've ever got to photograph. And this was down at Cataman, Alberta. And this was right at sunset, and he's actually in the shadow, but the grass on the top of the little knoll behind him is just, it's beyond my dynamic range of the camera, but it kind of made the shot, I thought, you know, it just, and then I had enough reflected light to kind of illuminate the ram. But it's a marvelous, marvelous bighorn, and it's probably, that's on the coal lease at Cataman, And because they've done all the reseeding and everything, there's food there like you wouldn't believe, way better than a ram would get off in the mountains most often. And there's a number of large rams there. This is back to Wilcox Pass. And this was the oldest ram that I ever found in Wilcox Pass. And he just made a nice picture with the fall foliage there.
How do you know he's old?
Well, you can count the rings. I don't know.
Oh,
you see the little rings? The first one on the from the tip is 1.5.
Oh, okay.
And then you see each major ring and you go back. And I think he's about 11 and a half years old.
Wow, okay.
And this is our local rams, and I call this snuggling rams, I think. And this is out on East Shoeshop Road. It's about 20 below. It had snowed a little bit that night, and they were all kind of huddled together there. And it just made a kind of a shot with a lot of emotion in it.
How far are you away from your subjects here?
I got my 600 lens.
Yeah.
And I don't think I cropped that one hardly at all. I'm not that far. Maybe 60 yards or 70 yards, something like that.
How long does it take them to get comfortable with you?
Well, they were just, they'd been down in the alfalfa field, and they were moving up, and they kind of all came together. And I'm on the road, actually, was where I took this picture, and the picture just worked. Mm-hmm. Maybe it's that outhouse luck again. This was actually at my place in Logan Lake before Carrie and I moved. And this was one of the nicer bucks that used to come into the yard. And I can't tell you that I climbed any mountains to get this one because I think I took it right off a sidewalk on the front of my house.
Was Logan Lake a good place for wildlife? Like, it's very high altitude there.
It's different birds than here in the winter and that. And of course, there's the resident deer, just like we got in Kamloops. There's no predators, generally speaking, right in town. So most of our mule deer today live in towns. This is a large bull elk. On that particular year, it was the largest bull elk in Jasper. A little story about this one, though. I went out to photograph, not on this morning, but another morning, and he was way over on the other end by the trees on that same meadow. And the next thing, he's coming my way, and I was outside of, with the truck, and here's me with the 600 and the tripod on my back, and I'm running around the truck, and the elk's running around too. And of course, Carrie's in the truck observing all this, wondering if she's going to need to get a new guy.
Oops.
And this is down by the Athabasca River, and you get that turquoise water. Haven't had a big flood or rain for a few days, and this is a marvelous bull just heading back up to keep his cows all together. And this was the biggest elk another year in Jasper, and this I called it Foggy Bugle, and it was a cold frosty morning, and here's the fog coming out of his mouth. And the only thing I would say about this is a lot why I don't photograph these guys much anymore, because I used to be a pretty good runner, but I've kind of lost that art. Now, this was one of my first cougar pictures when I bought that Nikon, and he was a big tom, and he was kind of looking down and giving us the glare, and I thought it was about the best picture you could ever take, but I've since discovered you can do better. This one I call Frosty. It was about 35 below that morning, and I was in the hoarfrost level, and she's looking down at me through the hoarfrost, and it just made a nice picture framed up with the hoarfrost. This is another one. It's a female, and you know, you get to the tree on one of these guys, like you treat them with your dogs, and you just go, wow, you know, because they're just such a magnificent animal. And anyway, we took my pictures, and then we leased up the dogs and thought I'd had a pretty good day. Now this is another one, and it's decided it isn't staying up that tree. And this shows the athleticism of these animals. Yeah. Any animal that can run straight down a tree and still control the speed and hold on to the tree, and then at 25 feet elevation, jump out over the dogs and is gone. You and I would have died. And this is just normal for these animals. That's a big Tom giving me the stink eye. And actually, he's on the top of a tree in a canyon, and I'm on top of the canyon looking down at him. And this was the last winter, the lynx that was out on MacArthur Island. People were feeding the ducks, and the lynx was feeding on the ducks. I'm not sure whether it was one duck or two ducks a day. And this is a picture I always just liked. I was up behind Barnhart Vale, and I was actually looking for cougar tracks, and this guy was running from going across from one aspen grove to the other, and it was about 20 below, and it just, to me, with all the hair in his fur above his quills, just made a great picture of a porcupine, kind of a simple composition. This is a little weasel, a short-tailed weasel. I was photographing birds, actually, in my place in Logan Lake, and this guy came up to steal my woodpecker fat, and he was in the sunlight for that moment. The background was in shadow, so it really highlighted the weasel. Call this the stare. It's a coyote. I was up in Jasper Park. And the coyote had gone up over the hill, and I'm packing my 600 back up over to get a picture of him. And he came over to look at me. So I got this picture, and the background is not the sky. It's the mountain range in shadow behind him.
Are you using flash in a lot of these?
No, that's just the light of the reflected light.
And are you pushing the eyes in post or not?
I don't know. I usually work on the eyes. I either darken them or lighten them, and depending on where I am, a little bit, and I sharpen them.
But they're sure razzle dazzle. Yeah.
And this is a billy goat. This is down, like, if you go along that road on the old Headley Road, from Princeton to Headley, there's always some goats up there. And the only thing is, it's pretty precipitous and rocky. But 10 years ago or so, I didn't mind going around there, but now I kind of look at the goats from the bottom. And this is kind of one, I don't like your crop on this one, Ken, but...
Sorry about that, yeah.
he's just relaxed. It's actually a female, and she had two cubs. And when I was guiding with my son, one of the other guides had seen her. He says she's got a brown cub, and she's kind of dark brown, and she's got a black cub, and they might be good to photograph. So I went over to look for him, and here's a great big black bear, and I tried to photograph him, and he left in the wind. But because the big male was there, she'd gone up a tree where there are two cubs, and here she is in this big fir tree just kicking back until old daddy's headed down on his way. This is a grizzly I call Stink Eye because he's giving me the stink eye, and he's kind of a young male, and he's feeding on this fresh green grass. And what he did just after this, there was a little depression there, and he went and he laid in that, and he just kind of would look at, his eyes are over the top, and he was almost daring me to come down there. This is when the 600 lens, you wish it was about a 1200 lens. This is in Jasper, and actually Terry and I were together there that day, and this is a mother on the right and a cub on the left, about 3 years old, and they're having a little wrestling match. I think it all developed from he wanted to nurse and she was fed up with him nursing. And so they had a little play fight there.
He didn't thought that nurse. Was you and I thought that was you and Carrie. Anyway.
Well, no, we get along better than that.
Do you? Oh, that's great.
Yeah. I call this one contemplation. And it's about a three-year-old bear. And he's been feeding on the dandelions. And he's a beautiful, light, almost silvery platinum color. A little bit of yellowish tinge to it. And he's given that little scratch. It's almost like a human type reaction. In other words, if you can put that into your animal pictures or your bird pictures, I think they jump another level of interest. I call this one egg explosion. And it's pulling this salmon apart. This is up in the Chilco River. It's in the last light of the setting sun. And of course, there's eggs flying everywhere as it pulls the salmon apart. Now, this guy thought he could be my helper. I don't agree he was a good helper, though, because he kind of chewed up all that that foam padding with the camo on it on the outside of my tripod. But I was real lucky. That's a carbon fiber tripod, but he didn't bust any of the carbon fiber. So it was just buy some new foam covers.
I think you should have sent it to the manufacturer.
Well, get so.
We're into birds now.
Okay, this one I just like because you don't realize the pattern. This is a common snipe. And, you know, when you look at ladies' sweaters or anything like that, I don't think any of them can compete with what nature has done. And this is just to give that snipe some camouflage. But it's stunning, the pattern you get. This is a lazuli bunting on a little wild rose bush. And they come through here every spring. There's a few around, and they're just a stunner with their colors. This is a Bullock's Oriole. Again, they come and they nest in the lower elevations around Kamloops here. And I was photographing actually a woodpecker's nest this spring. And all of a sudden I saw the Oriole and I guess he was nesting close by. So I got this picture in pretty good light. Now, this little bobcat here is licking his lips because he just stole my woodpecker fat that I was feeding to the woodpeckers. So again, this is off the porch at my house in Logan Lake when I still lived there. This was a picture that I entered in the North Shore competition. And I think it won the top nature award in that competition. White-crowned sparrow. This is just our old common Canada Jay or Whiskey Jack, as a lot of people call him. But I think in here, the picture is not just the Whiskey Jack, but it's the moment of takeoff. And I've got enough shutter speed and depth of field that I think it brings the bird out pretty well. Yet it shows a little bit of motion. This is on the ice up Tronkiel Creek, a little dipper. He was diving in the water and catching these little crusted insect larva that's on the rocks underneath. But on the ice and that, it kind of really highlighted them. This is a downy woodpecker on a ponderosa pine cone, and it snowed a little that night, and he's sitting on the cone like a beautiful little perch, posed up perfect. I always like a picture like this where he's got his head kind of tilted towards me. He's got his tail tilted towards. Well, that kind of means for one thing, the whole thing, because of a shallow depth of field is in focus. And it just, if you got something pretty like that for him to sit on, it really makes a beautiful picture. You could use it as a Christmas card, actually. This is a red-shafted flicker taken to the wing A lot of times you're shooting a bird like this that's up a bit against a blue sky. Well, a blue sky, if you got him in front light, is actually a pretty attractive picture, as this shows. If you got a silhouette against the white sky, well, it doesn't look near as good. This is a picture of, I call it hard landing. And the camera did 14 frames a second, so there's 3/14 of a second there. And, you know, it's a, in other words, it's zap, zap, zap. And I put it together in Photoshop to show how the flicker actually comes in to land at his nest cavity.
Boy, I can't see the merges anywhere there. Wow, that's good work. Yeah.
Yeah, well, it basically, the camera didn't move, Ken, so the background stays the same.
That's right, yeah, yeah.
So it's easy to cut and move, you know, it's not hard.
Wow.
And that's a nice pileated woodpecker shot. You got the babies all saying, "Mom, I'm hungry," and Mom's looking at the red-tailed hawk flying overhead. Now, this is a picture that I kind of liked. It's three trumpeter swans. It's down by a little pond by Merritt there on the Logan Lake Road. And what I liked about this, I got all the wings synchronized, and I got the two heads of the geese, of the swans, the trumpeter swans, against the white of the other. So it really showed them off.
Breathtaking, really.
This is a grebes, like this is a Clark's grebe. I took this down in Moses Lake, Washington. The western grebes also nest over in Shuswap, in near Salmon Arm, and they're almost as stunning, but these are a little more beautiful because they got the white around the eye, with the western grebe has a black around the eye. And that's a mating dance. This is one of our loons swimming underwater foraging for fish. And it's one of the few times where I've had a nice clear pond. I've been in the right place and the loon swam by me. And this is the hitchhiker just getting ready to fall off here. Mama kind of raised her wings and did a wing flap. And Junior there, who was riding along, he had to learn to swim a little more that day. Now, this is nice light in the morning. In other words, you get out on the lake, you try to find your loon in the half light of morning. And then as the sun comes on, you get this beautiful water, and you also get the light coming on the birds. It just makes the photograph. If you go late, it's too hot and the wind's up and you don't get these kind of pictures.
Hey, we've got to do 30 in 10 minutes, so name, rank, and serial number only. Thank you.
Okay. This is a California quail. I set up the perch and the salal, or not the salal, the Oregon grape, and that's the male and the female. Long-billed curlew. I tried to photograph these guys 10 days before. The curlew and the field were the same color. My camera would not focus properly. And yet I came back 10 days later, the curlew against the green grass worked 100%. This is a kestrel at its nest. And this is the male, just a beautiful, stunning bird. For a picture like this, you need to set up in a hide. Otherwise, they won't come into the nest.
What sort of hide do you use?
I got a little hide. I just sit in it on a chair and I got my tripod set up and I go there in the dark and come out in the dark at night. Mm-hmm. This is a harrier, northern harrier. That's the male. He's giving me the scream. Actually, I was hiking along and all of a sudden he started raising heck. He had a nest nearby. So I got some beautiful pictures of him on the wing. This sharp-tailed grouse, and this is just taken off. They do these little jumps on the lek when they're doing their dance, and they jump up about 5 or 6 feet in the air. And this is one of those jumps in the beautiful morning sunlight. This is a backlit one of a sharp-tail also doing a dance. You can see there's different ways to light your bird here. this is the fight out of the grass. And this is kind of a tough one, because when they explode out of the grass like that, for your camera to be on the right focal distance, most of these shots turn out blurry. Another one of the fight, of course, this is right in front of me, and that picture I don't think is cropped at all, and that's how it turned out. This is the picture that I won the top award with in the Pacific Zone. I think it got a 29 out of 30. This is a picture that I've entered in the open competition. It hasn't been judged yet, and it's two sharp tails fighting, and they're exploding up off their dancing lick, and it's just finished snowing, so it's kind of a bit of a still white and snowy. The little pygmy owl, just beautiful little bird. They're only about as big as a tennis ball. And certainly something that's a prize to be able to go and photograph. The biggest trouble you'll have is getting them out of the junk. This one, this is in our neighbor's yard. It had killed a junco, smacked into the window right by Carrie's head, left junco blood on the window, flew into the neighbor's tree and posed for me. A little burrowing owl coming in with a moth to feed its chick. This one actually got a second place award in the Four Nations competition, and it was a northern hawk owl with a bull and a chick in a rainstorm, and this was taken up by Tunkwa Lake. This another one with a young hawk owl with his bull. Mom had just given it to him, and now he's giving me the stink eye, and the next thing was he pulled the head off, and then he pulled the middle off, and then the rest of it went down the hatch. This is a great horned owl, just ready to take wing. Actually, that I'm up on a hill above him and a treetop below me, and that's actually a lake in the background. Now, this picture is one that when you enter it in a nature competition, doesn't do well, but to me, it's a kind of better than some of the others because it shows what really goes on. If one of these gray owls gets too near the whiskey jack's nest, this is what happens. This is a gray owl picture that did really well in a competition. Kind of simple, no distractions. This one also did well in a competition. I think it kind of just showed where they might live or hang. It had the lichen all hanging around them, and he's given me the glare there. This one did well. I think it came second in a cross-country competition, and this is flying over the snow. And the way that bird was lit was the sun was shining on the snow just before sunset, so it was like he was flying through a big softbox.
We saw this one recently, didn't we?
Yeah, this is one that I had entered in this, the Pacific Zone, where I won the gold medal. This is one of those pictures taken last spring. This is the other one. I think Brian liked this one the best, better than the one that did actually better. And again, it's just a ray of sunlight coming through the trees that hit the owl that's sitting on a lichen-covered stump. This is on a perch above my bird feeder table, and it's a pine grosbeak, the male. They're as stunning, I think, as the eastern cardinal, only this. So this is our red bird to photograph. This is the evening grosbeak, and this is on the same perch, only a different day, a little less snow. But again, a stunning bird. This is bringing home the fish for breakfast. And this is the eagle coming into his nest. Female is sitting on the side and the chicks are sitting there waiting to eat fish for breakfast. And this is actually put together. It's a composite. And the gray owl was flying along a fence, and I cut it out in Photoshop. I took a picture in the half dark of the fence post and that, and it was kind of a before daylight. It was kind of a weird lit picture. I took it and I flipped the background picture horizontally and put the owl in it, and turned it into black and white, and just
it's beautiful.
To me, it made a real nice picture.
Real feeling of no motion.
And this is one that I did some years back, but it's still one of my favorites. It was the Northern Lights up on the Peel River, just below where that picture of Carrie was up on the mountain. Carrie and I were on the mountain earlier. And that's the Great Big Dipper in the middle of the Milky Way. And the one bear's from one part of Alaska, and the other bear with the fish is from another. And I called it Aurora Dream. In other words, he's dreaming about the fish he's going to get.